Marcelo está no ar.
Good morning, and on behalf of the graduate program in astronomy of the Observatório Nacional, welcome to the third and last day of our special courses, Ciclo de Cursos Especiais in Portuguese, CCE. So since in 1996, Observatório Nacional has special courses to provide to graduate students and postdocs a broad view of select topics in astronomy, astrophysics, and cosmology. So every year, specialists from different areas are invited to give a course in their field of research. However, for the second consecutive year, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, we decided to organize a compact, virtual, and very special version of our special courses. Thus, I would like to say thank you very much to all the professors for accepting our invitation to be a lecturer in our virtual CCE. So thank you very much, Dr. Angela Bragalia, our today's speaker. And a special thanks to the organizing committee, Dr. Simone Daflon, Dr. Daniela Lázaro, Dr. Jailson Canis, and also Dr. Renato Dopik. So let's enjoy this last day of our CCE.
Okay, thank you, Marcelo. So it's a pleasure to have Angela Bragalia here with us today. So Angela got her PhD in astronomy in 1990 at Departamento de Astronomia, Universidade de Bologna. Sorry for my Italian. So since then, she's a researcher at the INAF, Observatório de Astrofísica e Ciência del Espacio. Angela Bragalia has more than 20 reviewed papers on resolved stellar populations, on galaxy, globular clusters and open clusters. And she's a member of some large collaborations in astronomy, such as the Gaia User Survey, Gaia, WEAVE, and JPS, which is known for most of you at Observatório Nacional. So today, Angela will talk to us about the importance of spectroscopy for stellar clusters. So please, Angela, and please, you can mute your microphone, and if you have some questions, you can raise your hand, and then I will open for questions by the end of this session. Okay, thank you very much, Angela.
Okay, thank you very much, Simone, and thank you all for inviting me to give this presentation today, and thank you for being here to listening to the virtual presentation, which should have been an in-person presentation and not the pandemic being imposing on all of us. And so I'm happy to be here today, and I would try to say something in the next hour about the importance of spectroscopy for studying stellar clusters. And since 1 hour is not a lot, I will only touch two things on globular clusters. We will see what is the importance of spectroscopy to define and the case of multiple population in globular clusters. And we will see how also photometry is very important to provide for providing key information on the multiple population. So this will be the only subject I will talk about for globular clusters. And for open clusters instead, I will present some topics which regard open clusters and which were treated by large spectroscopic surveys, in particular Gaia-ESO, because Gaia-ESO has a large part of the survey dedicated directly to open clusters. And from the beginning, please forgive me if I forget to mention something you are not familiar with, and I am especially sorry if I forget to mention anything about research done by other groups. I will present mostly things I've been involved in, but that doesn't mean that there are not that there aren't many more important works in the same field. So we'll start with a simple thing. Now that we have Gaia, maybe we shouldn't bother anymore to collect other data, because Gaia is already providing us a wealth of information on our galaxy, on the stars in our galaxy. However, Gaia has a very limited capability for spectroscopy, and in particular for stellar clusters, we need to complement the important and precise information Gaia can give with ground-based work. And we start with the globular cluster. Let's begin with the definition. So what exactly is a globular cluster? It may seem strange, but there is no unique definition of what a globular cluster is, because of course we can think of the most common kind of globular cluster we know in our galaxy. So it's a spherical aggregates of thousand or 100,000 or million of stars. But then not all clusters are so spherical. Not all globular clusters are so massive. Not all globular clusters are old. They are in our galaxy, but in the Magellanic Clouds, we have, for instance, massive stellar clusters, which are much younger than the globular cluster we have in our galaxy. So how can we call them? So, and just to give you an example, here I show two picture of two things. That one, the one that doesn't seem to be a cluster, is indeed the globular cluster Palomar 5, a small, old, and intermediate metallicity globular cluster. It's far away, and it's a dissolving cluster. It has two very well-defined tidal days. And the other one is indeed an open cluster. It has been classified like this since the beginning. It is massive, almost as massive as Palomar 5. It is old, almost as old as Palomar 5, but is much more metal rich. One is about 4% solar, and the open cluster is more than two times more metal rich than our sun. So there is not a very clear and unique definition of what a globular cluster is. So in the annual review of astronomy and astrophysics in 1988, so many years ago, Renzini and Fusi-Pecci presented globular clusters as the best example of simple stellar population, meaning a population made only by coeval objects and with the same initial composition, metallicity and composition. And that is very important, because simple stellar population are a very useful tool to understand the intrinsic properties, not only of the population we are studying, but also of galaxies, because galaxies, which are composite population, are made up by simple stellar population, by multiple simple stellar population. So by studying the properties of one, we may try to understand the properties of both. And indeed, looking at the beautiful color magnitude diagram on the right side of the figure, we may think that there is one single population shown here, as witnessed by the thinness of the evolutionary sequences. And this is a beautiful color magnitude diagram obtained with the Space Telescope cameras. And this has also been cleaned from interlopers using proper motions. However, not everything is so simple. This is not exactly the case for all clusters. And of course, there has always been the case of Omega Centauri with its multiple metallicities, multiple sequences, etc. But the problem is that Omega Sen is not the only globular cluster that shows peculiarities, if we want to call like that, when you look more closely at the evolutionary sequences. And for instance, on the right side here, I show the diagram, the color magnitude diagram obtained again with the space telescope of a normal, apparently normal globular cluster, NGC 2808, which however does show a triple main sequence. So we see here a main sequence on the red part of the color magnitude diagram, and then another two sequences, which are bluer and bluer. And this has been interpreted as a variation of helium content among the different stars. So the globular cluster we are seeing here is not monometallic anymore. It has not a single composition. Not all the stars were born the same in this cluster. And indeed, but 2808 is in some cases another exceptional case, like Omega Sen, for one thing, because it is very rare that such large helium differences show up in color magnitude diagram. You can see them if you look close enough with very high precision photometry, but not always. However, the first indication that globular clusters are not simple stellar population came from spectroscopy, because there is a star-to-star variation, at least in light elements, that we can see from spectroscopy. And first, from low resolution spectra, where variation in carbon and nitrogen were found. And the carbon and nitrogen varied in step. So in the same star, if nitrogen was increased, carbon was decreased in comparison with other stars of the same cluster. And a similar behavior was also found later in higher resolution spectra, also for elements like oxygen and sodium. And here I show a modern representation of such a kind of variation found among globular cluster stars. And again, this is for the cluster NGC 2808. And perhaps the most famous of those correlation and anti-correlation is between oxygen and sodium. And this is meaning that in the same clusters, there are stars that have oxygen and sodium values, which are similar to stars of the same metallicity in the field, and stars that have very different abundances of oxygen and sodium. And those variation are only seen in globular cluster stars. And initially, those variations were only found among red giant branch stars. So a simple interpretation could have been that they were due to mixing episodes and to variation of the surface abundances of those stars, because we know that during the lifetime of a star, the surface abundance of some light elements change during the in the evolution. And if you look here at the color magnitude diagram of very old and metal four field stars of known distances measured with high resolution spectroscopy, we can see that there are a few elements like lithium, carbon, and nitrogen that change during the evolution of the star. So they for instance, carbon decreases when the star is up on the upper part of the red giant branch, while nitrogen at the same time increases in the same region. But there are all elements like oxygen and sodium that were seen to be varying in globular cluster stars that do not change at all in old metal poor and low mass stars, such as those that are visible in globular clusters. So mixings cannot be an explanation anymore. And furthermore, those same variations were not found only among giants, but were also found among main sequence stars and subgiant brand stars. So stars located in these regions here, where no evolutionary changes would have been expected anymore. So why are we interested? Why do we care about it? That means that the stars that we are seeing now cannot have been produced, cannot have produced the abundances we see now in them. So if they have not produced those strange abundances, those variations, that means that we require an external origin for them. There is always the solution of calling for some kind of binary transfer of matter in binary systems, but that would imply that we see this phenomenon only in very few stars in each cluster, and this is not so. So the stars that we see with those anomalous, with strange abundances, must have formed from gas which add this composition. So they are complete, this is their composition, not only the surface composition. If they have not produced those abundances themselves, the gas must have been produced by a previous generation of stars, more massive than the one that we see now, and which were instead able to produce the abundance pattern that we observe today. So we're able to destroy carbon and produce nitrogen, for instance, and destroy oxygen and produce sodium and so on. And I don't want to enter the realm of models and kind of stars that could produce that. But that means that there must have been at least two formation episodes in the cluster, one that produced, for which the more massive stars produced those elemental abundances. Those stars lost matter that polluted the gas from which a second generation of stars formed. And then this is what we are seeing today. And the importance of this, that the presence of these abundance anomalies and this anti-correlation and variation among light elements means that we can give fundamental constraint on how the cluster formed. And those strange abundances have been produced by nucleosynthetic chains. First, the CNO, then the neon sodium, and then the magnesium aluminum cycles, which are active in stars more massive than the sun and more massive than those that we are seeing alive in a globular clusters, and which act at increasing burning central burning temperature. So the CNO cycle changes carbon into nitrogen and oxygen into nitrogen. The neon sodium cycle changes neon into sodium, etc. So at the end of those cycles, carbon, oxygen, and magnesium are depleted. Nitrogen, sodium, and aluminum are increased. And this is what we see in the globular cluster stars. And this is all very good. But if you want to give constraints, quantitative constraints to the model of globular cluster formation and evolution, we need to have very quantitative observations of many stars in a large group of globular clusters. So this is what we try to do with the FLAME survey of globular clusters. FLAMES is a multi-object spectrograph mounted on the VLT, and it can observe at high resolution about 130 stars at a time. So that was important because the previous observations of globular cluster were all done with single object spectrographs. So it is very painful to obtain information for more than a few ten of stars in each cluster. With FLAMES and with other multiple object spectrographs like that, it became possible to observe 100 stars in each of the cluster we wanted to observe. So we went on with flames and collected homogeneous observation for 28 globular clusters and collected a large number of red giant stars and a smaller number of stars on the horizontal branch. And we analyzed all the this sample in the same way, in an homogeneous way, so that it is possible to obtain quantitative information. And just to give you an idea of what we did on that, this is a presentation of the distribution of oxygen versus sodium for 25 of the clusters that we observed. And we can see that all of the clusters observed here show an anti-correlation between oxygen and sodium. So when a star has a high value of oxygen, has a low level of sodium, and vice versa. But even if all clusters display this kind of anti-correlation between the two elements, not all the anti-correlation are the same. But one important feature is that in each cluster, we can separate a portion of stars which have the same sodium and oxygen abundances of field stars of the same metallicity, and we can call of primordial composition, primordial origin, first generation. All those terms are used more or less indifferently in literature, and they mean more or less the same thing. Even if you say generation, you imply that there is a time delay between the thing. If you say population, maybe the two population are coeval and the pollution came by other methods. And this is something which has not been completely clear yet. But again, in each cluster, we can separate a fraction of stars which have a primordial composition, so those were the stars that were born at the same time of the polluters of all the other stars. And then we have stars with a modified composition that we called intermediate and extreme, but this is not relevant here. They are the so-called second population stars or second generation. And one important thing is that the fraction of first and second generation stars is about the same in all clusters that we have examined. We have about 30% of first generation, about 70% of second generation stars. This may vary a little with mass and metallicity, and it has been computed in a different way using photometry. But the important thing is that the second generation, the polluted star, are the majority of stars in the cluster. That means that the globular cluster must have been much more massive at its beginning, because only a fraction of the first generation star went and polluted the material from which the second generation star formed. So it's not a phenomenon limited to a few stars in each cluster, but it's something inherent in the nature of the star cluster that we are seeing today. And another thing that we could see is that if you measure precise abundances, the distribution of abundances is not a continuous trend, but you can separate using, for instance, clustering algorithm, different groups of stars. And this is important because if you can separate different groups of stars, perhaps they were polluted by different, in a different moment, by different polluters. So this is important to understand what went on at the very beginning of the cluster formation. Another thing that is comes clearly out from this work and from all other works involving multiple stellar population in globular clusters is that mass Mass of the cluster is the most important property that produces and shapes the multiple population phenomenon. Because if we look here at this plot and we see that the mass is indicated here by the absolute magnitude of the cluster, which is a proxy of the mass. So those are the low mass clusters and those are the high mass clusters. We see that the extent of the anticorrelation between oxygen and sodium measured by the interquartile ratio of them increases with cluster mass. And if we have a look at the distribution of all globular clusters for which a multiple population has been measured, and this is in a plot where we have age versus mass of the cluster, we see that almost all globular clusters in the Milky Way, this group here, show multiple population. The empty symbols are for clusters which have not been studied yet. And not only the Milky Way open globular clusters, but also clusters in the Milky Way satellites like Fornax or the Magellanic Cloud show multiple stellar population if they are massive enough. So all the high mass and all the clusters show multiple population. The low mass cluster do not show generally a multiple population, and the very young and the younger clusters do not show multiple population. And the open clusters, even if they are old, do not show any kind of light element anticorrelation. So this is important. And if this is just a list of the thing I've just said, so I leave it here because it's just a list of things that have been already said. However, spectroscopy, as I told you before, may be very painful, may be very difficult, because even with multiple object spectrograph, you can observe about 100 stars per cluster. And then if you want to cover the whole cluster population, it is almost impossible to do that with spectroscopy. It is almost because now with the spectrograph like MUSE, so the integral field spectrograph, you can do that. But at the moment, only at a very low resolution, which is not perfect to study the abundances in clusters like that. It is possible, but it has a much lower precision that what can be obtained with high resolution spectroscopy. So if we want to have information on the whole cluster and on many more stars that is possible in a reasonable time with spectroscopy, we can resort to photometry. And variation in light elements affect also photometry. Of course, it is less evident than in spectroscopy, because in spectroscopy you get lines for all the elements and you can measure directly the abundances, but also photometry can do some sort of separation and some sort of classification. And I show here the spectra of two stars which have the same atmospheric parameters, the same metallicity, but have different light elements abundances. One has high carbon and low nitrogen, and it's a magenta line. And the other one is a typical second generation star with depleted carbon, but much increased nitrogen. And we see that there is a difference in the spectra, of course, where the bands of CN or NH are. And if we can use a system of filters, of photometric filters that cover these features in the spectrum, then we see that the different fluxes in the filter due to the different abundances of nitrogen, for instance, translate into different flux level in that filter and in different magnitudes. So for instance, in the Strongren filters, you see that in the redder filter, there is almost no influence of the light elements. You begin to see something only when you go to the bluer filter, the violet, and especially the U filter. So one important thing is that if you can go bluer, then you can get more information about the variation, in this case, on nitrogen. And the same is true also for HST filters. They are wide filters, wider than the Strongren ones, but have an important feature that if you observe with the space telescope, then you get to the far ultraviolet, which is not reachable from the ground because the atmosphere, the Earth atmosphere cuts it out, luckily for us. And if you go down to about 3000 angstroms like this, you can begin to see also the OH molecules. So you can see differences among spectra, not only because of carbon and nitrogen, but also of oxygen. And so one important thing is go as bluer as you can and go to the ultraviolet. And another trick that we can play is try to use a large color range in your filter. So try to be as different as possible. And what I show here is an effect in the Johnson system and in the Strongren system of combining information in the U, B, and I bands using the QB index and plotting it against the normal V photometry. So you see that the first generation and second generation stars, population one, population two, call them as you like, are very different, especially in the red giant branch and in the main sequence phase. And the same is true if you use the Strongren system and use the CY index, which is a combination of U, violet, and Y, which is the analogous of the V magnitude in the visual band. So in this system of filters and in this combination of colors, first and second generation stars do separate also in photometry. And this is shown here for Johnson filters and Strongren filters using the QB and CY index. So the photometric sequences are very large, and you can separate first generation and second generation stars photometrically in both cases. But also, if we overplot on the photometric plots, the stars that were observed also by spectroscopy and were already classified as third generation, second generation, by means of here of sodium and oxygen, you see that they fall exactly as where they should. So this sequence is the sequence for the second generation star, and this is the sequence for the first generation star. And the same is true also for the Strongren filters. It's important. You can use photometry, and to separate things. And we can go even further in complexity, and we can go to what Milone and collaborators called the chromosome map. The chromosome map is a combination of five different filters on board the Hubble Space Telescope. Far ultraviolet, blue, and sorry, four filters, and the analogous of the I band in the Johnson system. And by combining differences among those filters, they were able to separate very well stars belonging to the first generation and the second generation. In this plot, if we move along this axis, you change either in metallicity or in helium abundance. If you move along this axis, you change carbon and nitrogen. So by combining those four filters, you can separate pretty well the two population of stars in clusters. And this is because a feature of carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen fall in the bands that you're using. And again, if you compare what you do with photometry, the gray dots are the chromosome maps of all those clusters, and you overplot the position in the same filters of stars that were observed spectroscopically, you see that photometry and spectroscopy seem to see the same thing, at least to a point. And this is for most of the clusters we are studying. There is a further level of complication. So globular clusters are not simple at all. If for the so-called type 1 clusters, we separate second generation and third generation, and everything is explained by variation of nitrogen or helium, without too much problems. There are always problems, but at least that we can understand pretty well what's going on. There is another kind of cluster, which Milone and collaborators here, Marino, define as type 2. Type 2 clusters present some further peculiarity. And the most important one is they seem to show also a spread in iron, not only light elements, but also iron and neutron capture elements, like barium, for instance. So that means that things are more complicated, and a more extended star formation must have been going on in them. One classical type 2 cluster is, again, Omega Sen. But this is not a problem. Omega Sen may be understood as a nuclear cluster of a dissolved dwarf galaxy. But we don't know if this is true for all the other clusters. One important thing is that iron complex globular clusters tend to be among the most massive clusters. So there is a possibility that they really were the nuclear clusters or now dissolved dwarf galaxies. And since we are here, I have to mention JPAS. JPAS has not produced the results in the multiple population field yet, but we have good hopes that it can in the future. JPAS works with 54 narrow band filters covering the whole spectrum, the whole optical spectrum. And that means that not only carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen can be traced by photometry, but also other elements like sodium or magnesium, or elements which have prominent features in one or more of the JPAS filters. So as I said, we have good hopes for the JPAS photometry. JPAS has just started operation, but I don't think any globular clusters have been observed yet. But one globular cluster was observed using the JPLUS filters. JPLUS is used, the JPLUS system is used also to calibrate the JPAS bands, but is a combination of Sloan wideband filters and a few selected narrowband filters that can separate abundances typical of first and second generation stars. And one paper has been published on the very metal poor globular cluster M15. And indeed, it seems that it is possible to use those bands to separate the multiple population. And so I hope that this will be possible also for more clusters using the more complete JPass system. So just to conclude and try to see if there is something important, we have seen that not only the different abundances are visible through spectroscopy, but they can be seen also using photometry. We need, of course, a very high precision photometry. Light elements that influence the most the photometric filters are carbon and nitrogen, the effects are visible especially on the red giant branch and the subgiant branch, but also helium abundances can show up, and we've seen that with the triple main sequence in NGC 2808, and helium affect mostly the main sequence and the horizontal branch. And if you have a narrowband system, then it is easier to play the game also with photometry and to separate quite easily the different population of stars in each clusters. And up to a point, the separation we do with photometry and spectroscopy agree. Also, when we look at photometric data, there are clusters that are not only separated in two main groups, first and second, but there are finer separation, and which I've not talked about here. And also that there are stars that do display a different iron content from the bulk of the stars. And also, if we look at separation done using photometry, again, the presence of multiple population and the entity of the separation is correlated with cluster mass. If you want to have an idea on globular cluster spectroscopy, you can have thousands of different sources, and I name here only Apogee because they have studied especially the multiple population in globular clusters, and this is very interesting. There are thousands of work done by on private data sets and not only on surveys, and it's interesting that we can now think to do with spectroscopy something very similar to what we do with photometry. So go to the center of the cluster and see each individual star. So MUSE, for instance, is an integral field spectrograph that can reach the inner globular cluster regions in a field which is similar to that of the Hubble Space Telescope. But at least now, this is possible only using low resolution. And then if you want just to give you a small idea of a very, very long and very extended bibliography, I've put here three slides with a tiny list of a very small fraction of all papers that have been dedicated to multiple population in globular clusters. So since we are almost out of time, I move rapidly to open clusters and the importance of spectroscopy for those smaller siblings of globular clusters. Again, we could start by defining what is an open cluster. And in this case, we have even more problems because we can begin to call open clusters things that are very, very young and are still embedded in the native cloud to more exposed clusters and to older and older clusters like those I show here. And the importance of studying open clusters is that they are very good particle tests and they are very good calibrators for everything. because open star clusters share a common origin, have the same age, down to a few million years. So if you look at them after 1 giga year, they are all the same age. They are all at the same distance, unless they are very close to us and we can see some internal dispersion in distance. They have the same initial chemical composition. So they are a better approximation to a simple stellar population than globular clusters are, at least for what we know until now. We have open clusters of very different age. So for instance, we can test all kinds of evolutionary phases from the formation one to the priming sequence phase to the main sequence and the evolved phases for giants. Being of very different ages, they also contain stars of very different masses. So we can test stellar evolutionary models, not only for the old and ages, the low metallicity and the low masses that we see in globular clusters, but for all ages and for all masses. So they are very important for that. And the detailed chemical abundances that we can obtain for open cluster is very useful to define the distribution of metallicity and the elemental abundances in the Milky Way. So it's important to study open cluster. But again, if you study open cluster, you need to obtain a large sample of open cluster. You need to obtain good quality spectroscopy. Low resolution is a possibility, but if you go to higher resolution, this is much better, but because you can obtain not only iron and maybe alpha elements, but you can get detailed abundances of chemical elements of all nucleosynthetic chains. And then you also need to cover the whole disk of our galaxy. So I put here an example just to show that we not only need to obtain large samples, go to high resolution spectroscopy, but also that we need to do so in a very homogeneous way. In the plot I put here, I show the so-called gradient for metallicity, so the variation of metallicity with the galactocentric distance in our galaxy as found based on the abundances of high quality spectroscopy compiled by Netopil and collaborator. And that looks very fine. But if you go to and compare what is the difference between different analyses for the same cluster, and here I compare simply all quality sample and low quality sample, you see that for the same cluster, the differences may be in metallicity, maybe also a few tens of decks, and this is not a precision good enough to understand what's going on in the sample. So we need to have a large sample analyzed with precision and in an homogeneous way. And spectroscopic surveys are an answer to that. For instance, the Gaia-ESO Public Spectroscopic Survey has analyzed a lot of open cluster. I give here a few slides which I will pass on very quickly, because there is just an indication on what you can find in the website of each survey. So Gaia-ESO is a public spectroscopic survey that has been going on for 340 nights with flames on the VLT, and has observed about 100,000 stars in all the components of the Milky Way, and in particular, it has observed stellar clusters. A few globular clusters, but a lot of open cluster, and has derived for all the stars in the survey homogeneous and precise radial velocities, stellar parameters, and abundances. And if since the survey is a public survey, all the raw data and now also all the reduced spectra are public and available to anyone through the ESO archive. And the complete catalogs for the final data release will soon be available from the archive for catalogs again at ESO. And the importance of Gaia ESO for Open Cluster is that about 40% of the whole duration of the survey was dedicated to study very extensively Open Cluster, meaning that for each cluster we observe with Gaia ESO from about 100 to about more than 1,000 stars in each field. Not all of the stars we observed turned out to be cluster members because Gaia ESO was done entirely before Gaia data release came out, and then we couldn't select cluster members based on anything. But also the stars which are not member of the open clusters are important. They are still member of the Milky Way, so they can be used for anything. So this is a plot to indicate that we observe stars in the whole cluster in the whole disk of our galaxy, and with ages from a few million years to a few billion years. And many topics were important for the open clusters in Gaia ESO. So we began observing, deriving the properties of individual clusters or star-forming regions, and studying the different evolutionary phases in them. And we tried to understand what is the distribution of metallicity in the disk of the Milky Way, and so on and so on. But just to give you an idea of what you can find if you are interested in the many papers dedicated to open clusters that are based on the Gaia ESO survey. And remember that you can always use the catalogs and especially the spectra to do your own analysis and find things that no one in the Gaia ESO consortium has already thought. And this is a very good thing. And this is just an example on a nearby star forming region, where Gaia ESO did observation of a few thousand stars that were selected as members based on a combination of spectroscopic properties and Gaia properties, so astrometry from Gaia. And it was possible to see that in this star-forming region, there is an ongoing star formation. The star formation is not instantaneous, but has gone on for at least 10 million years. And the region is expanding. Or we can have a look at the distribution of the metallicity in the disk of our galaxy using open clusters of different ages. And this has been done, for instance, in those papers which used the very young clusters in the vicinity of the sun, and older clusters which are also closer to the center of our galaxy. And one interesting feature was that, and this has been found also by others, but not so extensively, that the young clusters seem to be all rather metal poor with respect to the sun and with respect to older cluster. And there is a possibility that this is due to a peculiar chemical evolution in the disk, but the most probable thing is that there are some analysis problem because the young stars are also rotating, have strong magnetic fields, have spots, and so their analysis is very difficult. So analyzing large sample of stars gives you also information on the robustness of the analysis technique, this information is very difficult to get by if you only analyze one cluster or a few stars each time. Another thing that Gaia-ESO could do is to to be used in combination with the Gaia results. And this is an example based on the very first data release of Gaia, so only for the very nearby stars, and try to use the information you get from astrometry and from the spectroscopy, in this case, metallicity, temperatures, and gravities, to verify and calibrate the stellar models. And another thing which is important is that if you add to the information you have with Gaia, also the radial velocity for stars in each cluster, you can get a much more robust selection of cluster members. So you are sure that you are addressing you are addressing science using only the member of the cluster you're studying. So this is an example using M11. So this is the figure I show in a few slides ago, and this is what you get if you do the photometry of this field. So I dare you find the cluster here. But if you combine the information on the radial velocity we got with Gaia-ESO, with the information we get from Gaia, then the cluster appears as by magic, and then you can do your science on a robust and statistically important sample. And another thing that you can do is you can study the small variation in surface abundance that come by during the evolution of a star. And you can do that if you use a stellar cluster. And it has been done for globular cluster, but also for open clusters. And this is a case, this is M67, a nearby old and very well studied clusters. And we got stars on the main sequence, at the main sequence turn off, on the subgiant branch, and on the red giant branch. And if you compute the abundances for them, you see that this is shown for Iron, but it's done for many more elements. There is a decrease when star evolve close to the main sequence, and then the original abundance is visible again once you are on the red giant branch. So you have to be careful. When you look at stars in the field, you need to know the evolutionary phase of them if you want to be sure that the surface abundance you are seeing is the initial abundance. And this is important because one of the things that we dream to do is use chemical tagging to say for each star in the field of our galaxy where it was born, based on the chemical abundance it has. But you have to be sure that you understand exactly what you're measuring. And just very, very quickly, I mention here two more large spectroscopic surveys. One is Apogee. It's in the near infrared, in the H band. Again, it's a high resolution spectroscopy. They have already observed some 100,000 stars, and the number is increasing because this is in data release 16, but the data release 17 is expected next month, and there will be many more fields than those shown here. And again, Apogee publishes everything, spectra and catalogs once they're public, and you can get access to them using the organization website. And there are many ways to download all information that you need. And in the case of open clusters, there is a program, a special program on them in Apogee called OCAM, means Open Cluster Chemical Abundance and Mapping of the Milky Way. And they observed about 130 open clusters in the disk of our galaxy. And they got information on some of the stars in them. So at variance with Gaia-ESO, which was also focused on getting stars in each of the evolutionary phases in each of the clusters that were observed. In the case of apogee, mostly open giants were targeted, or in a few cases also main sequence stars, especially for clusters where only main sequence stars are present. But the number of stars they observed and they could observe in each cluster are less than in Gaia-ESO. So it is an important survey because it did lots and lots of clusters, but you can get less information on the individual stars in each of the clusters that you have. But again, it was able to observe cluster alone in the whole disk of our galaxy and derive the distribution of the metallicity. And again, there is a negative metallicity gradient in the galaxy. And this is a confirmation of what we already knew, but this is done on an homogeneous and large sample, and this is important. And in this case, it is also possible to derive the evolution of the metallicity distribution with time. And we see that older cluster had a steeper distribution than the cluster that formed later. And this is important to understand the chemical evolution and the formation of the disk of our galaxy. And last, I mentioned GALA, which is going with the instrument called Hermes. It's an Australian enterprise, and they have already observed 600,000 stars, and their survey is still growing. Again, spectra and catalogs are public after a while. And for open clusters, they did a good job in combining their observation with that of Apogee and got some information on the metallicity distribution. And one important thing that they did regarding that is that apparently the open cluster trace the distribution of elements not exactly in the same way as field stars do. So this is a variation of the metallicity of the slope of the gradient with different ages. And for the open cluster, the distribution goes like that, while for the field stars, the distribution of this slope is almost flat. So there must be some difference between the field stars and the open cluster population. And we need to take care of that when we do comparison on that. And finally, I mentioned three surveys that will be important for open clusters and stellar clusters. One is due to start in a few months from now in the Northern Hemisphere. It's called WEAVE, and it's on with the WEAVE spectrograph. It's a multi-object spectrograph working on the William Herschel Telescope, which is located on the Canary Island. It's an intermediate resolution survey, and we'll observe hundreds of open clusters and some globular clusters. And the important thing in this case is that the field of view is very large, so it will be possible to follow not only the central part of the clusters, but only the corona, the halo, and possible the tails that comes out from the cluster. Similar survey will be done by FORMOST, which is instead done by ESO on the VISTA telescope, so from the south, and there will be a survey observing all Milky Way population going on for 5 years. And finally, MOONS. MOONS is not a survey, it's an instrument. It will be on the VLT. It has the same field of view of FLAMES because it will be replacing FLAME. It has a smaller resolution, but it goes redder than the instruments mentioned until now. So it will also observe in the H band. And this is important because if you go to the infrared, then you can observe also the extincted population in near the center of our galaxy, like the bulge or the inner disk. And so with that, I conclude because it's the time is over. And I thank you very much for your attention. And I hope to see you soon, or at least some of you in person. And in the meanwhile, I just remember that if you are interested in stellar clusters, there are already huge amounts of data available, and in surveys, in archives, in public archives, etc. There will be much more in the future. We need synergy between all the approaches to study stellar clusters. And I've never mentioned in my talk models and theory. And this is a very important thing, but cannot be dealt in such a short time. And so with this, thank you.
Thank you very much, Angela, for this wonderful review on this contribution of the surveys to our understanding of the globular clusters and open clusters. It was really great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I'm open for questions. Marcelo raised his hand.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Angela. It was really, really a very nice lecture. Thank you. I have two general questions. I think you gave the answer to them in the last slides, but anyway, I will ask you just to confirm if I understood correctly.
Sure.
The first one is concerning, I think it was in your second or third slide when you show the image of Palomar 5 and also of another cluster, an open cluster.
Okay.
And you show that both have almost the same mass. They are both old clusters, and the morphology, they have different morphology, okay? Palomar 5, yes, exactly.
Is this one? Exactly.
And the open cluster has a morphology similar to a globular cluster, but it's an open cluster.
Exactly. Because they are stellar clusters, yes.
Okay. So my question is the following. Which are the criteria to classify a cluster as an open cluster or a globular cluster? Is just the location, the galaxy, and also the presence of multiple population and the absence of anticorrelation? These are the main criteria to really classify a cluster as a global cluster or as an open cluster or not?
I think that the classification is mostly an historical classification. So open clusters were classified as that because they had a few stars. This is an exceptional cluster with a mass similar to that to a small globular cluster. And they were located in the open cluster were smaller, located in the disk, they were more metal rich, and their metallicity is about solar, plus or minus 0.5 dex, but they are all close to solar, and they are generally younger. Globular cluster were traditionally halo population, metal poor, massive, old. Then, and this is the tip of the iceberg, but then there are massive open cluster, old open cluster, young globular cluster, metal-rich globular cluster. So it is difficult to say. I don't think there is a clear-cut separation. Once we proposed to define a globular cluster, something that shows multiple population. But this is a definition that it's just another definition. I don't think there is a clear-cut answer to your question. There are many things that separate them, but not only one of them. You must have many of them to say, okay, this is an open cluster, this is a globular cluster. So generally, open clusters are old, metal poor, and massive. And open clusters are young, metal rich, and less massive. But then,
okay.
At least no open cluster until now has shown any kind of flight elements variation like those we have in globular clusters. So at least they were formed in a different way, in a different environment, in a different moment.
Okay, great, thank you. And my second question is concerning the data that you used to study the clusters. You show many surveys and data from optical, and you also said that you should go to the blue and the infrared, to the blue and the ultraviolet, but you also show some data, important data from Apogee and in the future from the moons. So my question is concerning the,
Finish the question, because the answer is that you need to go to the blue to use photometry efficiently. Spectroscopy, it's another thing, but go on, please.
Okay, so now it's clear. Yeah, my question is concerning the James Webb Space Telescope and the ELT, that you have most of the instruments you operate in the infrared. So my question is, how do you expect that these instruments you contribute to the study of the clusters, the open and the global clusters?
Okay, you can do that. It takes more effort, but you can separate population also using the infrared. It has been done by the same group who has worked on the space telescope data, the group led by Piotto and Antonino Milone in Padova, etc. And they have obtained also infrared data on the main sequence of globular clusters, and they see that they can separate the population, because in that case, the molecule that operates should be oxygen. I don't take that. I'm not sure about the molecule that they use to separate the population, but I think it is possible. I know that it's possible to do also using the infrared, but it has not been done massively yet. For the space telescope, it was like, I don't say easy, but it was a good decision, because already there was the globular cluster survey done by Atta Sarajedini and collaborators many years ago using the V and I filters, and they were obtained especially to determine distance and age of the globular clusters. So what they did with the UV legacy survey of globular clusters is to reobserve the same clusters, adding the blue and ultraviolet bands with the same instrument. So that was, of course, not easy, but it was a good idea. With the new infrared telescopes, you will have to think about the different indicators, but it is possible.
Okay, thank you very much, Angela.
Thank you. Marcos Felipe has a question. You have to unmute, Marcos.
Yeah, helps.
Yes, go ahead, Marcos.
Sorry, but I don't hear anything. Am I having problems?
No, Marcos, we don't hear you. Maybe if you want, you can write your question, and then I can read it to Angela.
I think it's the sound of my... Okay. Now I...
Okay. It's okay now.
So, hello to everyone. My name is Marcos. Congratulations, Angela. for your great presentation. And I am a graduate student of Simone Dafon in the Observatorio Nacional. And I want to know about the, how can I differentiate a third generation of globular clusters of a second generation? Because I saw it once that Paiotto 2015 conclude that exists a third generation, and I don't get it. How can I differentiate? Is about a classification of the lines of nitrogen and OH lines, or someone else?
Okay. Third generation means that you don't have you mean that could be, for instance, for 2808 Piotto, because you see it is difficult to say okay, let's go to this. I need to share my window again. And let's try to do like that, if it is possible. Share. So you are seeing my screen now with the first generation, second generation, and the five. Are you seeing my screen now?
Yes.
Okay. So here we have, for instance, 2808, and here we have first generation stars, those which have the same, it is exactly the opposite. I'm sorry about that. Those are the stars, because this is magnesium and sodium instead of the axes are mixed, are rotated. So this is the first generation. Well, let's say this is the first generation and this is the extreme population. So you see that you can group stars according to some criteria about their abundances. And the thing is that to go from those star here to those star here, you need to pollute the matter from the initial from the initial composition. And I don't know if this is the case for this cluster, but there are cases where to go from star here, from a star here to a star here, there is no problem. You only need to produce some oxygen and sodium abundance in the first generation of star, then you dilute it, and then according to the how much this is diluted in the primordial gas, you can obtain star here, 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 and here. But in some cases, there is no way that by using a simple source of pollution, you can go from one star here to a star here. You need to go by two different ways. And that means that you need to have at least two different kind of polluters. Let's say, more massive stars and less massive stars. So in that case, I would call for a third generation, not only a second generation. I think this is what Piotto meant presentation. And if it is for 2808, then I think this is related to the fact that in 2808, you see a main sequence composed a main sequence composed by at least three different sequences. And three different sequences mean three different helium abundances. And since helium, so you mean to have an original helium abundance and then something that produced stars that have this helium abundance and something that produced stars that have those the third helium abundance. So this is maybe is what the E defined third generation.
Okay. Oh, thank you very much. It's a confusing question. Well, so it's just this. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, Marcos. So I'll read a question posted in the chat by our colleague Hélio Rocha Pinto. So he said it's a very interesting lecture, and he asks, is there any known relation between the presence of a second generation stars and the HB index used to classify the horizontal branch morphology?
Yes, there is a relation, because the HB index is related both to metallicity. It's related mainly to metallicity. So the HB index changes for changes of metallicity. But the effect of having second generation stars means that you also have stars which have a slightly different helium abundance in their core. And so they may form slightly different horizontal branches. So there is a relation between the presence of a second generation and the extent of the anticorrelation you find between light elements and the extension of the horizontal branch. So clusters which have extreme horizontal branch stars usually have also very long anticorrelation. One example is, again, 2808. And there is a strong correlation between the maximum temperature reached on the horizontal branch and the degree of variation among globular cluster stars in light elements. So yes, there is a correlation between them. And it's mostly due, I think, to different helium, because higher level of helium produce bluer horizontal branches, stars.
Okay. I have a question. So you have shown this radial gradients traced by open clusters in the plane of our galaxy, but is there any pattern in the special distribution of abundances in globular clusters?
There is a slight abundance gradient also for globular cluster, meaning that the inner region globular clusters are more metal rich than the outer halo clusters, and also because you count the clusters in the bulge of our galaxy and close to the bulge of our galaxy, which are really metal rich. So in the bulge, you have both metal intermediate and metal poor and metal rich population. And this is true also for globular clusters. The problem with globular clusters is that lots of them were not formed directly in the Milky Way, but were formed in satellites of the Milky Way that were later accreted. So it's more confused than for the open clusters, which were formed in situ in the disk of the galaxy. So there is a confusing situation. And for instance, if you plot the age metallicity relation for a globular cluster, you see that it's different from clusters that were created in situ and for clusters that were accreted by our galaxy. So it's a combination, but you can find it, but it's more complicated than for the open cluster, because there is not only one source, only not one, but there is no single birthplace like for open clusters. Sorry.
Okay, so we have one more question here. By Wilton. Yes, Wilton, go ahead. You can open your microphone. Yeah, you can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Nice to meet you, Angela. It's a pleasure to me, and now you. And thank you for your talk. And my question is simple, is about the Gaia ESA survey. And that means the survey is in the end. What do you think is the best contribution of the guest for the study of the open cluster? And because the guest provided the high resolution in these data, and in the study of the gradient of the abundance of our galaxy.
Okay, Gaia ESO is important because not only because the gradient will be an important thing to derive, and this is but this can be done also by studying 3 or 4 stars per cluster. You can do that because since the cluster is, at least we believe it is homogeneous up to a certain degree, taking into account dilution and etc. But it's okay, and evolutionary changes for carbon, nitrogen, and so on. So let's say that each cluster is homogeneous. So to derive the gradient of abundances, you only need to observe a few stars per cluster, because then, and so for Gaia ESO, instead, the important things for me is that the entire population of each cluster was studied, from the giants to the main sequence turn off, to the main sequence and the pre-main sequence if present. So you follow the entire population of a cluster at the same time with the same instrument. And this, I think, is the strength of Gaia ESO, not the number of clusters observed. It's okay. We did 80 in the end, but Apogee did more than that. But then they had only a few stars for each of them. So they can give only, let's say, integrated information on the cluster.
Yes.
I think that the most important thing is that you observe the whole cluster, the whole population of a cluster, of course, or the whole, depending on the distance, of course, because we are limited by that, but at least we could get a large fraction of all the population of the cluster in each of the cluster. I think this is the most important contribution. And the resolution helps, because the UV spectra were taken, so you can get information on all the nucleosynthetic chains with high precision. And the other thing is that we got lithium abundance for the clusters. So for the young cluster, this is important because lithium abundance is a use indicator. It's something that you use to select cluster member, even when other methods fail. So lithium is another important factor of Gaia ESO, because it was we observed specifically to get lithium for our clusters. Lithium is Apogee cannot do it because there are no lithium lines in the infrared. but the galax can observe lithium, and they did, but not so extensively.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. The Gaia's survey provides the great information for the all stars in this region, and the spectra with high resolution. That's good for obtain the results and the obtain the measurements of the proper motion, for example, that stars. In the regions with the high pollution, for example, Carina region, that's my work with Simon. That's amazing things the data from the gas.
Yeah, thanks. And even before Gaia, it was possible using only radial velocity to see that some clusters were really formed by two or more groups. So in the Vela region, for instance, it was possible to see that a few clusters that were thought to be one single grouping of stars were instead two kinematically distinct groups. So this is important to understand how the cluster formed. And this is because we could observe a few hundred objects in the same cluster, in the same region, not only a few stars.
Yeah, that's a good thing, because you can put together the all information for the Gaia and the gas and make the mix, because to provide one solution about that's stars.
Exactly, and I think this is as for the Orion nebula and the Orion clusters and the Orion star forming regions using Apogee.
Okay.
If I remember correctly, that was Apogee was used for that. Orion was not possible from the
Gaia. Thank you very much, Angela. Thank you for nice meet you.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any other question? I don't see any other raised hands here. Okay, so thank you very, very much, Angela. It was really a comprehensive review of this recent results of these surveys.
Very quick.
But it was really great. Thank you very much.
And thank you for inviting me. Bye.
Thank you. Face to face soon.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye.